Hello friends, and welcome to the part 2 of our discussion on the carbon cycle. Now we will be discussing the microbiology of cellulose decomposition. Cellulose is abundant in plants, and plants, they are abundant on the surface of this earth. Plant litter, it is, that is the dead leaf, branches, twigs which fall on the ground, or even take for an example a dead plant. Herbs, shrubs, everything which is green, which is vegetation, which is biomass, it dominates the earth, and therefore the cellulose as a decomposition and its role in the carbon cycle is important. Now this carbon is just like money. If you just go on earning and don't spend it, what's the use? Just like that, if carbon is accumulated in large quantities and is trapped without releasing, then that is not what you can say a sustainable thing for the life. If life and the organic systems have to move over on the surface of this earth, then it is very necessary that the carbon needs to be recycled. So we have to see which are the reservoirs of carbon and how this carbon can be released back in the environment. One of the reservoir, there are many reservoirs, this may not be a major, but one of the reservoir from a microbiological perspective is cellulose. We have seen in our last discussion the significance of carbon cycle, as carbon is one of the most important element in the biological system and constitutes 50% of all the living organisms. Carbon dioxide is present in the atmosphere, and two main processes are there, as we have seen, balancing of photosynthesis and respiration. That is the one which governs the recycling of carbon in the environment. So two processes are significant here: conversion of the oxidized form of carbon into reduced organic form, that is which we have seen by the photosynthetic organisms here, and restoration of the original oxidized form of carbon through the mineralization of organic form by microorganisms. This we discussed in our last lecture. Now today we will see the carbon which is trapped in the polysaccharides. This lecture and the next lecture will be dealing with the two major polysaccharides which are trapped in the plant material in the form of cellulose and starch. What are polysaccharides? Polysaccharides, these are very large polymers composed of tens and thousands of monomers or monosaccharides joined together by glycosidic linkages. Means these polysaccharides are monosaccharides joined together by glycosidic linkages. So basically they are units of glucose. The three most abundant polysaccharides are starch, glycogen and cellulose. Starch is present in, as you know very well, the plants. Starch and cellulose in plants, glycogen in the animal tissues. So these are the three, what you can say, items or which are trapping the carbon. These are the three systems or stockholms of carbon. These are referred as homopolymers because each one of them yields one type of monosaccharide, that is glucose, after complete hydrolysis. When, if you can see this here in the figure, this is a plant material. It is made up of cellulose, lignin, hemicellulose. When this will be completely degraded, you see these molecules of glucose are formed. Heteropolymers or heteropolysaccharides, these contain sugars, amino acids or some non-carbohydrate moieties additional to the monosaccharides. So heteropolymers, these are very common in gums, pectins and other substances as it comes to plant material. Cellulose and starch, these are the two most important polysaccharides which we will be studying. And in nature, they serve as a variety of functions, the primary being energy storage in the plant cell walls. Okay, and as I said, as plants, these have dominated the earth in the form of jungles. Today it may be a point of debate whether plants, they dominate the earth or not, but still there are forests, there are rainforests, and vegetation is at large, and humans, they are also struggling to maintain the vegetation. So with this concept, that is a huge dominating plant on the earth's surface, soil is a natural depository for cellulose. Means whenever a plant dies, whenever there is litter, whenever there is twigs falling off, it falls down onto the soil, and soil becomes a depository for these materials. So starch I will be discussing in next lecture, but just to give you a fair idea, starch is a mixture of two polymers, amylose and amylopectin. Natural starches, it consists of 10 to 30% of amylose and 70 to 90% of amylopectin. As you can see, single glucose units, they are joined linearly by alpha 1-4 linkages, and this branching which is there, branching linear joining is alpha 1-4 and the branching is alpha 1-6, then alpha 1-4 linear chain, like that a polysaccharide is formed. Why we have to see in brief starch here? Because some parallels, some comparative is drawn with cellulose when it comes to structure. Complete hydrolysis of starch, it yields glucose finally, but it is steps. As you can see, starch is hydrolyzed to dextrins, dextrins to maltose, maltose to glucose. So ultimately the final product is glucose. The human body, we have amylase, several microorganisms, they have amylase enzymes or group of enzymes. This is not a single step reaction, it is a multi-step reaction, so multiple enzymes are required. So our body, the soil microorganisms, they possess the capacity to synthesize all these multiple enzymes to collectively degrade the starch, which is sequentially, it is a sequential process, and amylose, amyloglucosidase, endoglucanase, various groups of enzymes are there. We will see this in our next lecture, but today we will be focusing on cellulose. Cellulose is a fibrous carbohydrate and it is linear in nature. It is more linear than starch. Starch is branched with alpha 1-6, but here beta C1 to C4 bonds, thereby beta 1-4 linkages. Now cellulose, as I said, it is being fibrous, it can be amorphous and crystallized forms also, but that is after some chemical or enzymatic action which takes place on it. So it is found in all plants as a structural component of the plant cell walls. As the earth is covered with vegetation, as I have been saying, cellulose is the most abundant of all carbohydrates, and it accounts for more than 50% of the carbon found in the vegetable kingdom, that is the green kingdom. 50% of that is cellulose. Okay, 50% of the carbohydrates is cellulose. And just like amylose, cellulose is also linear, but it differs in the glucose linking, where just like glucose, they have two, alpha 1-4 and 1-6, but here only beta 1-4 linkages are there. The cross linking is by hydrogen bonds. You can see the linear chain is formed by beta 1-4 bonds and the cross linking is by hydrogen bonds. So this extreme linearity, completely linear in nature, it allows a great deal of hydrogen bonding between the hydroxyl groups of the adjacent chains. Means one chain is running, the another chain, hydroxyl and the hydrogen group, they form, and this results into densely packed fibers. This is all in the plant material. This is where the carbon is trapped, and this has to be released for the carbon cycle to function. So as a result of this, cellulose, it exhibits very little interaction with water. It is not soluble in water or any other solvent. Okay, so cotton, wood, for example, they are completely insoluble in water and they have certain mechanical strength, that is due to the linearity of the structure. Now if you see cellulose, finally when it is broken down, all these linkages, they are broken down, it will yield glucose, but that has to be enzymatic. Even acid hydrolysis does take place, but when there is a random breaking the linkages and some dimers, trimers, monomers, these are formed, they are called as cellobios. Cellobios is 2 units of glucose linked together, and when that is also broken down, single unit results into glucose. So cellulose, it yields D-glucose after complete enzyme or acid hydrolysis. We humans, we are unable to metabolize this cellulose as a source of glucose. We cannot, because we don't have enzymes. Animals, they do eat, but they also cannot synthesize the cellulase enzyme which is needed to broken down cellulose, but they have certain organisms in their gut. Just like we have Escherichia coli, they have cellulolytic bacteria, cellulose degrading bacteria, which helps them in cellulose digestion. Our digestive enzymes, they lack the or the digested juices which are there, that is the enzymes, they lack any enzyme which can degrade the beta glycosidic linkages in cellulose. So we can eat potatoes because potatoes is starch, but we cannot eat grass because we don't have the enzyme to break down these linear molecules, that is the beta 1,4 linkage of glucose unit. We cannot do that. But there are certain microorganisms in the gut of, we call them as the ruminating organisms. In Hindi or Marathi, it is called as Ravant Karanare Prani. Ravant Karanare means those who ruminate. They keep on chewing it, provided they break down it mechanically and provide it to the microorganisms present in their rumen. So there is a separate study of microbiology called as rumen microbiology. Those interested, they can study methanogenic bacteria. I think a small unit will be discussed in microbial ecology, the rumen microorganisms. The presence of these microorganisms in the digestive tract of herbivorous animals such as cows, horses, sheep allows these animals to degrade the cellulose from plant material into glucose, and they utilize this for their energy. There are certain termites, the wood, they bore the wood. Do they have digestive enzymes? No. Their gut is also containing cellulose degrading bacteria. So termite also contain cellulase secreting microorganisms. Cellulase is the enzyme. It is a group of enzymes. When you see endo, here you have endo beta 1,4 glucanase enzyme. Here it is exoglucanase enzyme, beta glucosidase enzyme. 4 to 5 groups of types of enzymes are there. Collectively, they are called as cellulases. So cellulase secreting microorganisms are present in the gut of termites also. So this is all about cellulose. Now, what is the role of cellulose in carbon cycle? Why we are studying all about cellulose? As I said, carbon trapped has to be released back into the atmosphere. My body, let us say your body, it is containing some carbon. It is trapped now. As long as we are alive, it is not being given into the environment. Other organisms cannot utilize it. We are utilizing. So our lifespan, let us say, is 100 years. 100 years man lives, he accumulates carbon, nitrogen, hydrogen, oxygen, phosphorus, he dies, it is liberated. A deep sea or core of the earth, there is carbon which cannot be released. So this is just like the money or currency. You earn because you want to spend. So life forms over the millennia, or 1 million years, 2 million years, when the organic life system arised on this earth, this recycling only has made the life system flourish. It create a biodiversity. You see, there is a biodiversity. Every year there is extinction, maybe there is new life forms coming on the face of this earth. Why this is happening? Because of the continuous recycling of the elements. Newer life forms horizontally and vertically, genera and species, they are growing on the face of this earth. And that is only due to recycling of elements. Carbon is one of the most important element in this global biogeochemical cycle. And in that, if enzymatic hydrolysis of cellulose is one of the most important carbon source in this biogeochemical cycle, and if it is not enzymatically hydrolyzed, then the key step in this global carbon cycle will be halted. It is very important. So despite its abundance, the release of this cellulose for the circulation is only done by microorganisms only. Animals, they eat grass, they eat plant material, but they cannot digest. The animal have microorganisms in their gut, in their rumen, in their stomach. They degrade it. Okay. So despite its abundance, only a small percentage of microorganisms can degrade cellulose. And because the cell wall which is there, it is very hard to degrade. There are at least 5 distinct reactions or enzymes or mechanisms by which different microorganisms, they can degrade cellulose. 5 enzymes, 5 different ways for degrading cellulose into 5 different compounds, but ultimately the product is glucose. Cellulose degrading microorganisms are very difficult to cultivate in the laboratory. Huge research is going on, because if we can utilize this cellulose as a carbon source, then it will be a great, like for biofuel instead of starch. If you use cellulose for ethanol production, then it will become a big energy resource. So studies are on that. So as I said, to release this cellulose into the environment, the only way is microbial degradation, because microorganisms are the only living systems on this earth which can enzymatically, organically, in an eco-friendly way, degrade cellulose and release it into the environment, make it simple for the ecosystem. So microbiological decomposition of cellulose is one of the most important process in nature. All those systems which contain cellulase enzyme to degrade cellulose, you see, bacteria are there, actinomycetes are there, fungus is there, archaebacteria are there, and these are present in soil, water, extreme environments, plants. These are present in the intestine of animals, this enzyme cellulase, and aerobically and anaerobically it can degrade the cellulose via exocellulase enzyme, endocellulase enzyme, beta glucosidase enzyme and cellulosomes. These are the various mechanisms by which this complex carbon source can be converted into simple element glucose. Now, why I am not speaking ahead of glucose? You know what happens with glucose. It enters into EMPH cycle, it enters into TCA cycle, electrons are liberated, it enters into the respiratory electrons transport system, and it is simplified, it is released back into the environment. So the microbial degradation of cellulose is one of the major necessary step to balance the opposing reactions between synthesis of cellulose and degradation of cellulose. So there always is catabolism and anabolism. To maintain this, microbial degradation is a very important key step in the ecological cycles. So what happens when it is degraded? In the soil, it forms soil organic matter, it forms humus, decomposition of the plant material and the simultaneous return of all the nutrients to the soil in the form of litter, and betterment of physical characteristics of the soil. Soil becomes more and more fertile. So that is one of the key thing which happens in nature. The knowledge of breakdown of this cellulose by microorganisms, it yields many perspectives, okay, for various types of microorganisms which reduce this cellulose via various mechanisms, and it helps in the biogeochemical cycles. So we'll be seeing the microbial degradation of cellulose as a key reaction in the global biogeochemical cycle. So cellulose, hemicellulose and lignin, these are the three prime components of plant. Cellulose will be converted to glucose. Hemicellulose is tough, and more tough is lignin for degradation. So because hemicellulose, it contains xylose, arabinose, this contains pentoses, mannose, galactose, glucose. Lignin is more, that is the part which covers the cellulose, and it is very tough and thick to break it down because it contains alcoholic sugars. So worldwide photosynthetic fixation of CO2 is very large, 15 into 10 to the power 9 tons of dry plant biomass is degraded annually by microorganisms. Almost half of this material, it consists of cellulose. And so of all the biological systems, cellulose 28 to 50%, 20 to 30% hemicellulose, and lignin 18 to 13%. This is fixed in the form of fixing carbon dioxide and converting into cellulose, hemicellulose and lignin. There are other constituents also of the biomass, means it is not that carbon dioxide is fixed, only cellulose, hemicellulose and lignin is formed. No, there are other components like proteins, lipids, carbohydrates, chitin, starch, pectin, etc. These are also a form of the or part of the global carbon cycle. Those who are interested, you can see the degradation of these also, that is protein degradation, lipid degradation, chitin degradation, starch degradation, pectin degradation. This also forms a part of the cycle. Now when we talk about microbiological degradation of cellulose, there are two key reactions: the relationship of the organism to the substrate and the mechanism of breakdown of cellulose. There are two ways, as I said, aerobic and anaerobic. I will not be dealing about anaerobic degradation because that doesn't take place somewhere in a very good fertile soil. It is anaerobic degradation usually in sewage, we see it in the rumen of the animals which are degrading cellulose in their stomach, that is rumen microflora. they have anaerobic degradation and methane is formed. Of course, this does forms a very important part of the carbon cycle, but here we are dealing only with aerobic reactions. So in degrading or attacking the cellulose, microorganisms, they produce hydrolytic enzymes, and this is liberated into the medium. If I am growing a fungi on a plate containing cellulose, it will secrete enzyme, it will act on the cellulose, and then the cellulose will be liberated, the cellulase will be liberated, cellulose will be degraded, and the substrate will be not only hydrolyzed, but it will go inside the it will go inside the cell, and inside the cell that will be then metabolized into the energy source, that is metabolism takes place. This is the general scheme for microbial degradation of cellulose materials. Now, cellulose decomposition, as I have emphasized, has a very important role in the carbon cycle. All the biomass which is there, this biomass, when it is broken down, it is broken down into lignocellulose, cellulose, hemicellulose, and glucose. So as it is one of the most abundant organic material in plant, it is readily attacked by many species of fungi and bacteria in soil. This process of cellulose decomposition to carbon dioxide and simpler sugars is summarized in this three reaction. On the screen you can see, cellulose enzymatically with cellulase is converted first into cellobiose. Cellobiose by beta glucosidase is converted into glucose, and glucose, you know, by various reactions of the EMP-TCA cycle is converted into carbon dioxide and water and other end products. So this is the global carbon cycle from the cellulose perspective. For this, as you have now, you should have come to know that cellulase enzyme is very important for breakdown of cellulose, and unless breakdown doesn't take place, carbon cycle is not going to get completed. The microbial degradation of cellulose by aerobic microorganism converting into carbon dioxide is summarized this, which you know very well, glucose plus oxygen, carbon dioxide and water. So this cellulose, which is a complex polymer, linear polymer, is acted upon by enzyme endocellulose, and it is converted into linear branches, which is called as cellobiose or just simple cellulose, and a combination of endo and exocellulose, exocellulase, converts it into cellobiose. Cellobiose is broken down of the linkages, but still it is not a monomer, and beta glucosidase is the enzyme which converts it into monomers of glucose. So what is a cellulase enzyme? Cellulase is a group of enzyme which catalyzes the breakdown of cellulose to form oligosaccharides, cellobiose and glucose. These enzymes, this represents a class of enzymes which are produced by fungi and bacteria, and they hydrolyze cellulose. So we'll be seeing some examples of bacteria, fungi, and how they, what are their specialities. As you can say, the enzyme cellulase, it is a key molecule or a key compound in the global carbon cycle, because that is the only enzyme, and it is present only in microorganisms, fungi as well as bacteria and some archaea. So cellulase, these are the key enzymes involved in the global carbon cycle by degrading cellulose into soluble forms. Cellulase, it hydrolyzes a single substrate, cellulose. So cellulases are a group of enzymes, and their prime fraction is cellulose. So if you are talking about this plant cell you see here, it is a complex structure made up of microfibrils, and if you see there, it contains hemicellulose, lignin and cellulose. Cellulases acts only on this, whereas lignin and hemicellulose, they are acted upon by different group of enzymes called as hemicellulases, ligninases. Okay, cellulases, it hydrolyzes one single substrate, that is cellulose. The complete enzymatic system of cellulose, it consists of three, broadly you can say five. Main action is three, but additionally five enzymes, I will explain it in next slide. These enzymes, they combinedly, synergistically, that is in combination, act on cellulose and convert it into glucose. They are different in different organisms. like fungal cellulases are different, their action is different. Bacterial cellulases are different, their actions are different. And fungal cellulases, unlike bacterial cellulases, they have a carbohydrate binding moiety. That is protein moiety is there. So it is a complex enzyme with a complex function, and a huge study and research is going on this enzyme even today. So as I said, 3 to 5 types of, or you can say groups of cellulases are there. 5 types of cellulases based upon the reactions which they catalyze. Cellulases 5, hemicellulases 3 groups, and ligninases, they have different depending upon the substrate which is containing, what lignin composition which is there. If it is high in phenol, high in which matter, lignin, then it has different types of enzyme systems to hydrolyze it. But we will be focusing here mainly on cellulase. So 5 types of cellulases are there. Endoglucanase is one. Endoglucanase is the first one which cleaves the cellulose molecule at the internal bonds, and it breaks down the beta 1,4 linkages. And endoglucanases, it reduces the length of cellulose. It doesn't make monomers, but some length is reduced. Exoglucanase is a group of exocellulases which hydrolyzes cellulose to form cellobiose, decellobiose, and then ultimately to glucose. So exoglucan, endoglucanases within the cell, exoglucanases secreted outside the cell. Cellobiases are third group of enzyme, third type, which acts on cellobiose units, that is disaccharides, trisaccharides, tetrasaccharides. Long chains, they are randomly cut. When they are randomly cut, it will result into 2 molecules, 3, 4, whatever. They will be called as cellobiose, means disaccharides, trisaccharides, tetrasaccharides, so on and so forth, to form some units. And this will be called as beta glucosidases. These are substrates for beta glucosidases, and that will be converted into glucose. There is a fourth group of enzyme called as oxidative cellulases. These are enzymes which depolymerize cellulose into smaller units, that is cellobiose dehydrogenase is one example which catalyzes the conversion of these different tetramers, dimers, monomers into more simpler forms. And there is one distinct various totally different group of cellulase. It is called as cellobiose phosphorylases. Here one interesting aspect, there are few microorganisms which contain cellobiose phosphorylases. These are similar to cellobiases, but only that for hydrolysis water is not needed, but phosphorus is needed. All these reactions or enzymatic reactions, they require water. Moisture is needed. For an enzyme to function, moisture is needed, because water molecule, this facilitates the breakdown of these bonds. But here there is one enzyme called as cellobiose phosphorylases which doesn't require water, but it requires phosphorus. So these are the 5 classes of enzymes. Now we will just in brief see, there are hundreds and thousands of microorganisms which can degrade cellulose. So these are called as cellulolytic microorganisms. So the microbial degradation of cellulose, as you can see, fungi are there, bacteria are there, these contain enzymes, and these enzymes, these break down these hydrogen bonds and linkages and convert the polysaccharides into monomers. Microorganisms which degrade cellulose, they are abundant in nature. They include both aerobic and anaerobic fungi and bacteria. Many, they grow under extreme conditions of temperature and pH. They are found in almost every habitat. And the fungi, they are more efficient in this reaction to produce cellulolytic enzymes. Therefore, they are exploited industrially also. So let us see the microorganisms involved in this. There will be different microorganisms for hemicellulose, lignin, pectic substrate degradation, which is not covered in this discussion. We will be mainly focusing on those organisms which degrade cellulose. So the endo alpha 1,4 beta D glucanase enzyme acts on these. Cellobiose is there, glucosidase is there, cellobiosidase is there, the fungi which decompose, bacteria which decompose. There are many fungi, many bacteria. In the slides, you can pause and see the names here. In the further slides, I will be detailing the name of the organisms. So cellulolytic fungi, first we will see the group of fungi, and then we will see the group of bacteria. In nature, there is a continuous degradation of dead plant material, because as I said, plant litter is maximum. So these organisms, these are called as saprophytic microorganisms. Some wood fungi, they are called as wood rot fungi. They degrade wood. And there are three types of wood rot fungi, namely white rot fungi. This is the first figure, white rot fungi picture, growing on wood. All they grow on wood. Second is the brown rot fungi. And the third is soft rot fungi. So white rot fungi, they are heterogeneous group of fungi, which are the only microorganisms which can degrade all the wood components. Example is Coriolis versicolor. Second is brown rot fungi, Basidiomycete species. They grow on wood and their hypha, they can degrade wood by sending the hypha from a significant distance. So that is one of the special characters of brown rot fungi. And the soft rot fungi, it is the wood which becomes soft. You see the figure. If I just crush this wood, it will become powder. Like that wood is there, and that is the soft rot fungi terminology given to the mechanism by which it makes the wood soft. Of course, cellulose is degraded by cellulase, and cellulase is the enzyme which makes it soft. Mainly Ascomycetes group and fungi imperfecti, this is one species, they primarily attack and make the wood soft. So these are the cellulolytic fungi. If you see the cellulolytic microbes, the fungi, they break down lignin. Inside the lignin, there is hemicellulose, cellulose, and cellulolytic bacteria act on cellulose to give rise to the glucose units. But the toughest part is breaking the lignin. But a combination of microorganisms, fungi, bacteria, etc., they stimulate the fungal response, they stimulate the fungal enzymatic response, and then slowly, it may take many years, months, days to soften and rot. But slowly, the fungi, they solubilize the lignified tissues, and then it gives rise to breaking down of cellulose and then glucose. So cellulolytic anaerobic bacteria are there, which are basically methanogens. You can see on this, pause this video here and just go through the name of the organisms. Huge species of fungi in cellulase production are out there in the nature, continuously working 24/7 for releasing the carbon dioxide and carbon which are trapped in the cellulose. Aspergillus, then as you can see, Humicola, Fusarium, Penicillium species, Trichoderma, Trichoderma viridi and Trichoderma raisii, these are Trichoderma spiralis, these Koniji, these are all one of the most dominant species of fungi which can degrade cellulose. So fungal cellulolytic enzymes, this is, you see, one book, journal which is published in 2018. So even in 2018 there is a book, a complete research book called as fungal cellulolytic enzyme. So you can see how much research goes on with respect to these activities, as they are a very important part, not only in bioenergy production but also in the global biogeochemical cycles. So the pattern of hydrolytic enzymes, as I have been saying again and again, is breaking down the branches. Okay, so there are various types of enzymes. There is diversity in the mechanism of enzymes. All these fungal cellulolytic enzymes are not same, but the mode of action is same. What are enzymes? They are protein. Their active site is different. Their amino acid chain sequence is different. So there is a diversity in the composition of the enzyme, but action is same. The next group of microorganisms which degrade cellulose is cellulolytic bacteria and their cellulase enzyme systems. The degradation of cellulose by bacterial system, it occurs both aerobically and anaerobically. If you see this graph here, the major bacteria which are present in soil and which have the capacity to degrade cellulose are Bacillus species. All this is Bacillus. In this, the blue color is Bacillus subtilis. So in soil, these are the spore formers, exist for hundreds of years, thousands of years, and they have the capacity to degrade starch as well as cellulose. The degradation of cellulose by bacterial system occurs aerobically as well as anaerobically. And a measure of this system, if it is aerobic, it is converted into carbon dioxide. If it is anaerobic, it is converted to methane. Now, these are all trapped in natural environments like swamps, marshes, soil, river, lakes, sediments, composts, etc. Of special interest is anaerobic digestion of cellulose in the herbivorous animals in their stomach, in the gut of the insects, that is the wood borers. They have cellulolytic bacteria inside their gut and they help them. Just like fungi, degradation of cellulose by bacteria, which are present in the gut, which are present in the soil, which are present distributed all over in the environment, the work action is by mixed culture. It is called as consortium. They work by forming a consortium and they hydrolyze the cellulose to simple sugars. Of course, the reaction is same. Again and again, if you see the reaction of degradation of cellulose by any cellulase enzyme, either from bacteria or from fungi, mode of action is same. So they are characterized by endo beta 1,4 glucanases. They are classified or named on the basis of the bond which they break. That is, if they are breaking it within endo, outside the cell exo, and they act on beta 1,4, so therefore they are called as beta 1,4 glucanases. So many bacteria, they do not have beta glucosidase like fungi, okay, but they still can metabolize the cellodextrins and cellobios by phosphorylases type of enzymes. So when we talk about the bacteria, here you can see the list of bacteria which have the capacity to degrade the cellulose. Hundreds of bacteria are there, that is, as you can see, anaerobic and aerobic systems, they are involved in degradation of cellulose. Primarily the cellulolytic bacteria, as you can see here, they can degrade the cellulose, see the reaction, into cellobios plus glucose, then lactate plus ethanol plus acetate. Once pyruvate is formed, then it will enter into various molecules. So cellulomonas, cell vibrio, cytophaga, herpetosiphon, thermoactinomycetes, eubacterium, clostridium, all these microorganisms. Again, I would recommend you to pause this slide here, just go through the name of the organism, see what organism interests you and have a more detailed study about it. So these are the list of bacteria which are capable of degrading cellulose by cellulase and contributing to the global carbon cycle. So let us just speed through some cellulolytic bacteria. Each figure there shows either the activity or a simple microscopic photograph or electron microscopic photograph of the name which I have shown there. So this is an electron microscopic photograph of Cellulomonas. Cellulomonas, it is the genus of bacteria of all whose members are cellulose degrading. There are at least 8 distinct Cellulomonas species: Cellulomonas biozoeta, Jalvigiana, Celelesa, Geldia, Carti, Euda, Turbata. Different organisms in the different regions which were discovered, their names are given. The main product from hydrolysis of cellulose by the extracellular cellulolytic enzyme is cellobios. Even in fungi it is there, even in bacteria it is the same. These enzymes may be responsible for hydrolysis of cellobios to glucose, and then it is fermented by the glucose fermentation pathways. In the soil, predominant Bacillus species are there. Genus Bacillus, it is made up of large number of spore forming bacteria. The soil is dominating with this. All have the capacity to hydrolyze cellulose with cellobios as their main product. Okay, out of which some bacillus, they contain enzymes for hydrolysis of hemicellulose also. This is Bacillus in soil. Pseudomonas, in this plate you can see Pseudomonas aeruginosa is spotted in the middle of a cellulose containing plate, and you can see the zone of clearance which is detected by a red dye. Zone of clearance clearly indicates that it is an exoenzyme which is secreted and the medium, cellulose in the medium is degraded. So Pseudomonas is a large group of rod shaped bacteria. It is gram negative aerobic, and Pseudomonas fluorescens variety cellulosa is one aerobic rapid cellulose degrading bacteria. The difference in bacterial enzyme system like in Pseudomonas is that it is a multi-component enzyme system. It is not only one. Means when an enzyme is formed, it is made from a polycystronic mRNA molecule. Means it contains more than one subunits. So two extracellular enzymes, which is namely called as A and B and C, A, B and C, three cellulase A, cellulase B, cellulase see these combine to form a big cellulose multi-component system to degrade cellulose. Cytophaga, this is the last example in the lecture today. The genera Cytophaga, Herpetosiphon and Saporocytophaga, these belong to the family Cytophagaceae, and they inhabit the soil, sea, freshwater and degrade wide range of polysaccharides including cellulose. The picture here is an electron microscopic photograph of Cytophaga Hutchinsoni, which is degrading a filter paper. So this large part here is electron microscopic picture of a filter paper fiber, cellulose fiber, and this small rod shaped bacteria, they are degrading this cellulose. So these are some of the cellulolytic bacteria. Finally, actinomycetes. The picture here which you are seeing is plate, nutrient agar plates, and 1, 2, 3 to 9 species of different actinomycetes are shown to degrade different capacities of cellulose. Means cellulose degrade in different capacities by these 9 different isolates. So thermoactinomycetes, the group thermoactinomycetes and thermomonospora are cellulolytic streptomyces, and they are thermophilic in nature. They grow, though even though they grow best at 40 degrees, they can degrade cellulose up to 60 degrees centigrade. These bacteria also produce the byproduct cellobiose, and they also have enzyme cellobiase, which is associated with the mycelial fraction. So these are all the bacteria and fungi which are responsible for the cellulose degradation and contribute to the global carbon cycle. Having said this, finally, I would like to say that many insects are also there. Termites are also there, which feed on cellulose. But remember, termites and insects which feed on cellulose, just like the cows, horses, buffaloes, which eat grass, they cannot degrade cellulose. We cannot degrade cellulose. There are microorganisms present in their stomach, gut linings, which help them degrade it and make available them glucose. So this is a remarkable area which is neglected for studies, the gut organisms of various insects in the environment and their gut flora, which is degrading the cellulose and thus forming cellulase enzymes. So finally, just the whole lecture, I would like to summarize once again for the main purpose that you should not forget the role of cellulose in the carbon cycle. The global carbon cycle, it involves both biological and geochemical components. Like biological components are there, geological components are there, physical chemical components are there, CHNOPs, carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, phosphorus, sulfur, all these are trapped somewhere, have to be released back. And most of the microbiological process is done by enzymatic hydrolysis. So enzymatic hydrolysis of cellulose by microorganisms is a key step in the global carbon cycle. Despite its abundance, only small percentage of microorganisms, they can synthesize cellulase enzyme. There are 5 distinct mechanisms which we have seen, and cellulolytic microorganisms and their cellulases are extremely diverse in nature. They are diverse because the plant kingdom is diverse in its vastness on this earth. So cellulose degrading microorganisms, they are very difficult to cultivate. Research is going on this, and every day new cellulolytic degrading mechanism is being found out by the researchers. So here we come to the end of microbiology of cellulose degradation. My next lecture will be on the microbiology of starch degradation. As there are microorganisms with respect to fungi and bacteria which can degrade cellulose, there are microorganisms with respect to bacteria and fungi which can degrade starch. Starch is very easy to degrade, we can degrade it, and it is very simple reaction. Of course, a multi-step reaction, but a simple reaction as compared to cellulose. Cellulose was more complex, is more complex for microorganisms to degrade. So the next prime carbon reserve from a microbiological perspective is starch, and we will be seeing the degradation of starch with respect to the microorganisms. So till then, I hope you go through this cellulose degradation once again, try to imagine its role in the global carbon cycle, and see what more insights and inputs you gain from your own study. So I would like to hear from you your inputs regarding the global carbon cycle. In our next lecture, we will be discussing starch degradation. Till then, goodbye. Hope you study in more detail for this topic. Goodbye. Thank you.